Govinda Gupta. I am a urologist and an andrologist from New Delhi, India. Today we'll talk about the men's health scenario. What beyond drugs? Patients with erectile dysfunction, patients with premature ejaculation, patients with sexual disorders, tadalafil, sildenafil, Viagra. What beyond that? So today we will take only the subtopic of erectile dysfunction. What is the new treatment modalities available with which we can salvage 30 to 40% of our patients who are not responding to medication? So what is the importance of men's health clinical practice? So as practitioners in any branch, it may be urology or any other branch, if a man is coming for treatment, there is a high probability that he will have some sexual dysfunction in some form. Either he may be suffering from low libido, or he may be suffering from some form of erectile dysfunction or some grade of ED or some form of early discharge problem. But because of the inhibition and societal stigma and lack of awareness, neither do doctors ask the patient and neither do patients share with the doctor this problem. But if you even momentarily ask a patient, side se bhi kuch sex mein problem hai kya, toh 90% of patients will always respond in the positive. Ki problem hai, we have some problem. But because they think there is no treatment and because doctors also think that there is no treatment, many of the patients are just left untreated. Early diagnosis and treatment can significantly improve erectile dysfunction symptoms. So somebody who has mild erectile dysfunction may benefit just from lifestyle changes and some early doses of medication. Can play a crucial role in identifying and managing patients, especially patients suffering from ED. But only if we ask. If we understand the latest treatment and approaches, then we will be more confident in trying to diagnose these conditions so that we can offer them better solutions. Why is erectile dysfunction such a big thing for India? India is the diabetes capital of the world. 77 million people in India will have diabetes or will develop diabetes over time. And diabetes causes erectile dysfunction. Diabetes is one of the major causes of erectile dysfunction. And these are a large population of patients who require proper management and treatment. Again, hypertension, obesity, depression, and stress. All of these are contributing factors, and a large percentage of patients with one of these factors will also have erectile dysfunction as a contributing cause to his wellness and his disease process. Now again, this is just a rough screenshot. It says that 10 to 15% of men have erectile dysfunction. But in my clinical practice and also on discussion with other colleagues, almost 40 to 50% of men have some form of erectile dysfunction, either mild or moderate, or maybe they have ED, but they're not having sex frequently, so they are just ignoring the problem. Erectile dysfunction's definition is very clear. Inability to achieve or maintain an erection is called erectile dysfunction. So many times as doctors, we think that not getting an erection is erectile dysfunction, but many patients get an erection. Erection comes, but they're not able to hold it enough to complete the act, or they lose the erection during the act. So even not able to maintain an erection, not able to maintain the erection long enough, or getting soft during erections is also classified as erectile dysfunction. So if somebody is not able to complete the act, then even he requires treatment. Then as physicians, we know the pathophysiology. The most common pathophysiology is vascular, which can be arteriogenic, which can be venogenic. Now, arteriogenic erectile dysfunction is very commonly seen in diabetes, but venogenic erectile dysfunction, which is now increasing, is very commonly seen. Now, venogenic erectile dysfunction basically means that the patient gets very good, very hard erections. But whenever they try to penetrate, whenever they try to do sex, then losing it because the veins, the valves are leaking. Now, this erectile dysfunction is very commonly seen in young men due to chronic sitting, due to lack of exercise, due to poor pelvic floor, due to the overt habit of over-masturbation that is seen in the society. The other common is hormonal, again due to low testosterone in the aging population. So many times as physicians, we see a testosterone report and then we see that it is in the normal range and we consider it to be normal and we say that no testosterone is in the normal range, it is okay. But the testosterone levels that is between 300 to 800 is defined for a population between 20 years and 70 years, which is not true. Second problem with testosterone is that it is a range. So some patients may have a testosterone which is mid-normal, but they may respond with higher levels. So trial of testosterone supplementation in younger men could be an effective alternative to treat erectile dysfunction. Then psychological components, yes, but I think that psychogenic erectile dysfunction is overdiagnosed because whenever we don't find a cause or whenever a young man comes, we give him Viagra, he does not respond. So we classify him as psychological erectile dysfunction. Whereas psychological erectile dysfunction is not that common. Now, these are the common drugs. That are available to all practitioners to prescribe to the patients. The most commonly to use drugs is sildenafil and tadalafil. Vardenafil and avanafil are the newer drugs. So most of us know about these medications, but sometimes we are not able to. So most of us know about these medications, but we are not able to sometimes rightly prescribe this for our patients. So first, I will make some important points that are important for clinical practice when using these medications. So both sildenafil and tadalafil can be given in daily dosing. So sometimes we are giving patients only sildenafil SOS. We tell them that when you want to have intercourse, you take the medication and you use it. But lower doses like 25 mg or 50 mg of sildenafil can be given daily at night or daily in the evening if the patient is young or if the patient wants to have intercourse more frequently. Tadalafil again is an SOS drug, but tadalafil in lower doses can also be given at night. Now there are two emerging roles of tadalafil daily dosing. One, tadalafil daily dosing at night causes nocturnal erections, which prevents hypoxia in the penis and the corporal bodies, preventing shrinkage and improvement of erectile function over time. Second is nightly tadalafil restores morning erections for many young men, giving them confidence and making them feel normal again. And many of them, the psychogenic component improves. But if we have exhausted our medical portfolio, is there something available in the non-surgical side or non-medical side for treatment of erectile dysfunction? So one is PRP. PRP, the same PRP that is used for knees, the same PRP being used for hair fall. PRP or P-shot, that is intracavernosal platelet-rich plasma, can help 30 to 40% of your men not responding to tadalafil and sildenafil start responding to the drugs. So P-shot or PRP is now no longer investigational. Now there are number of meta-analyses that are showing that PRP can help salvage diabetic as well as early erectile dysfunction patients and make them respond to medication again. So if you have some idea about PRP, PRP basically means that you take the patient's blood, we filter out the WBC or the buffy layer, we filter out the RBCs, the platelet plasma that is left behind. In that platelet plasma, there are two ways. Either we can activate it, we can form a fibrin matrix with calcium, or even inject it without that. The PRP is supposed to, there are many theoretical reasons why it works. One, the platelets itself disperse inside the penis, giving rise to growth factors, which stimulates new blood vessel formation, as well as there is a concept of peripheral stem cells that help in improvement. So the AUA or the American Association says that there's limited evidence and it is an investigational protocol, but other professional bodies like EAU as well as ISSM now highlight the potential benefits. And there are a lot of research papers in the past 2 or 3 years which say that PRP and PRP plus shockwave therapy can help salvage your patients with erectile dysfunction. Still, a lot of research is pending which patients to choose, selection criteria, what dose to give, how many injectables to use. But P-shot is now slowly and steadily coming in the mainstream of treatment of erectile dysfunction. Second is low intensity shockwave therapy. So what load retrieving shockwave therapy is that with a device, we give focused or radial shockwaves to the penile vasculature. Now, these shockwaves cause micro trauma and micro damage inside the penis. They disperse plaques. They remove calcification. They're helpful in Peyronie's disease. They improve blood supply via indirect inflammation. So there are many different machines of shockwave. The radial shockwave that is used for physiotherapy is not effective. You require something called as focused shockwave. They're separate machines. These focused shockwaves focus the entire energy at points. And this is what which causes improvement. So there are two types. One is focused, one is radial. The machine that is cheap, the machine that we use for elbows and joints is not the one we use for the penis. There are specific erectile dysfunction treating shockwave therapy machines that are available. And these machines have a lot of positive research. Again, I will not bore you with research, but all the studies point to show 30 to 40% improvement in men in terms of hardness, in terms of sustainability, in terms of use of medication. Many of the patients who are taking tadalafil 20 mg will shift down to 5 mg. Many patients not responding to medication will improve.